system, a weapon of mass destruction. There are some things in you innately that you are not going to tolerate, that the rest of your family bloodline rolled over and played dead for. But I declare and decree in this house that the Lord is about to break generational curses. Do me a favor, look at your neighbor and tell them this has got to stop. This. Be the first one in my family not to be a closet alcoholic, then let me be the first one. If I'm going to be the first one in my family not robbing Peter to pay Paul, to pay that Bartholomew, then let me be the first one. If I'm going to be the first one in my family to graduate from college, then let me be the first one. But whatever the devil did to my family before today, he's waiting too late. You got to know now, Antioch, that Saul's greatest failure is Esther's greatest challenge. All right, let me say that again. Some of y'all missed that. Saul's greatest failure is Esther's greatest challenge. I want you to understand that what you're going to have to deal with, the rest of your family bloodline was not equipped to handle. But there's something so special and distinct about you that the only thing you share with your family is DNA, molecular structure, enzymes, and blood type. I don't know who I'm preaching to in here, but have you ever been at a family reunion? Have you ever been at a holiday cookout? Have you ever been at a family gathering? Scratched your head, looked around the table, and said, how in the world am I related to you? We don't even know how you grew up in the same house. You're trying to figure out why is it that whenever the Lord blesses you, it's always your family hating on you. That when God takes you to another level, you got to look at the phone and say, can I call them or can they handle it? God said, I had to put you under the divine adoption program because your ways are not their ways and your thoughts are not their thoughts. They can't stand you, watch this, because they don't understand you. They don't understand why you're in church on a Tuesday night, why you're lifting up all the hands, why you're giving God the glory. They didn't know you had a great grandmama in South Georgia who was praying with no degree, three false teeth, young and healthy. When Mordecai sees Haman, Pastor Wicker, he said, there ain't no way I'm going to bow down to that joke. He said, my grandfather bowed down, my father bowed down. There ain't no way I'm going to bow down to the thing that's trying to kill my family. Don't look at your neighbor, just elbow him and tell him, I refuse to bow down. I refuse to bow down. Now, whenever you refuse to bow down to the enemy's vices and grips, get ready for attack. But y'all don't believe me? Mordecai had some nephews. Their names were Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. They said, King Nebuchadnezzar, I know your gold god looks good, but I refuse to bow down. Can I tell you this? When you're grown up in God, you are no longer impressed by silly stuff. I don't care what kind of car you drive, where you live, how much money you got in your bank account. I want to know how much favor you got on you. Is there anybody in the house tonight? You made up in your mind, I didn't come to church to make friends. If you don't like my hair, build a bridge and get over it. If you can't stand me, get out of my me. You've been crying and toiling. You've been waiting for God to do something in your life. And you don't have time to play church. But you can't leave.